So far in the series, we've seen how quantum mechanics is an incredibly powerful tool for building amazing technologies. However, we've only really explored this in the abstract. Right now, quantum researchers are working hard at bringing us closer and closer to a future where quantum tech is everywhere.
Today, we're at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign visiting some of the top quantum engineering labs in the country. In this episode, we're going to talk to some amazing scientists from all across the Midwest who work in quantum engineering, from sensing to computation to communication.
First, we'll be talking to Shimon Kolkowitz, a professor in quantum sensing at the University of Wisconsin-Madison.
Then, Victory Omole, a quantum computing engineer from a startup company based in Chicago.
And finally, we'll be talking to Nadya Mason, a researcher in quantum communication right here at Urbana-Champaign. Let's get going. Using quantum mechanics to make incredible technology isn't just a dream. It's happening right now in labs all across the world. Today, we're talking to physics professor Shimon Kolkowitz from the University of Wisconsin-Madison about some of the exciting applications of quantum engineering, including what his group is working on and how he got into this rapidly expanding field. Professor Kolkowitz, welcome to our lab.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Robbie. It's a pleasure to be here.
So can you tell us about some of the applications for quantum technology that are making a difference today?
Yeah, that's a great question. So as you said, you know, there's a lot of research going on in quantum technologies all around the world. And I would say, broadly speaking, we typically divide the kind of cutting edge quantum technologies into three different groups. There's quantum computing, which is probably the thing you've read the most about in the newspapers and the public hears a lot about. That's a really exciting area of research, but it's still developing, and so far we don't have so many real-world applications of quantum computers just yet. They're really challenging to make. Another area of quantum technologies is this idea of quantum communication and quantum networks, and there the idea is that you can actually use quantum mechanics and the impact that an observer has on a system when they measure it to communicate in a provably secure way. So you and I could communicate and be sure that no one was listening. And then the last kind of quantum technology category is something that we call quantum sensing. And that's the area I work on. And I would say so far, that's the area that may be starting to have the most immediate near-term, you know, impacts in the real world. And there are applications of quantum sensors to things ranging from, you know, fundamental physics to medicine and biology to even mineral exploration. You know, we're really using quantum sensors to learn more about the universe around us.
So can you tell us a little bit more about what you and your research group are working on right now?
Yeah, absolutely. We try to use quantum systems to measure things. And I have a couple of different systems that are these quantum systems that we work on. So one is actually, we use little defects in diamond. So these are actual pretty sizable pieces of diamond. And inside of them, there are sort of single atom scale defects that act just like atoms trapped inside of the diamond. And we can use those to measure things. So we can use them to measure magnetic fields, electric fields. We can use them as very good thermometers. We can use them to measure strain. And these nitrogen vacancy centers in diamond are very good tools for learning about what's happening at interfaces, what's happening at surfaces, and how can we use the information that we learn about these surfaces to actually improve, you know, quantum computers, quantum technologies. So that's one system I work on. The other system I work on is actually atomic clocks, but a new kind of class of atomic clocks called optical atomic clocks. The optical clocks that I work on, they have accuracy and precision at the sort of 18 digits of precision or accuracy. What that means, one way to understand that is, if I took two of these clocks and kept them ticking side by side from the Big Bang until now for 14 billion years, they would both agree on the age of the universe to better than 1 second.
Wow. Do you think you can share with some of our viewers some tips if they want to get involved in quantum technologies and some of the things they would need to prepare for a career in quantum science?
My junior year, I took my first quantum mechanics class, and I really struggled. That's the worst grade I ever got in any class. I got in the first quantum mechanics class that I took. And as I kept taking classes in it and actually getting to see some of these really weird and counterintuitive and almost impossible sounding phenomena actually manifest themselves in the lab and in the experiments that we worked on, you know, I just kind of fell in love with it, and I decided that this is what I wanted to do. And I think it's great, you know, for your viewers to kind of challenge themselves a little bit, and also to feel start to feel a little bit comfortable with just that can't be right feeling. Yeah, the most important skill is probably just curiosity and excitement.
Quantum computing has the potential to revolutionize research, from pharmaceuticals to farming. Today, we're going to talk to Victory Omole, a quantum computing researcher at Super.tech. Tell us a little about yourself.
Sure. My name is Victory Omole, and I'm a quantum software engineer at Kolkowitz. Mm-hmm. Previously, I worked at Super.tech, which was a quantum software startup spun out of Chicago. So right now, the quantum computers are very faulty. They're very noisy. And we try to make quantum computers better through software. So we try to program quantum computers to be more efficient and to do calculations more accurately. I got into quantum through open source software. It's very welcoming and open, and anyone can join it. So anyone can participate in improving quantum software now. And that's how I got into quantum. I never actually took a class for quantum computing or quantum mechanics or anything. I just started contributing to these projects online. That's how the CEO of the company I work for heard about me and hired me.
So tell us a little bit more about how different quantum computers are from regular computers.
Sure. So a quantum computer uses quantum bits, or called qubits, to compute. And classical computers, those use bits, which bits are just information which is 0 or 1. And quantum bits can be in a superposition. And the cool thing about quantum bits being in superposition, alpha qubits, is you can entangle them. And once you entangle them, you unlock potential computational resources that you wouldn't be able to access by just using classical bits. So you can factor way faster. And factoring is important because most of our security, like our credit cards and our banking information and everything, is based on factoring. So if you can factor a huge number efficiently, then you can break all cryptographic systems. And then you can also use it to perform a lot of quantum chemistry experiments and just quantum simulation experiments in general. So these are the types of things that quantum can just do way more efficiently than the biggest supercomputer you can make.
So tell me what made you passionate about quantum to begin with. Yeah.
So the thing that made me passionate about quantum is because it is a new scientific revolution. And the cool thing about scientific revolutions is it completely changed how we see the world. The field needs a lot of people to work on these things.
Yeah. It's an exciting field to be in, for sure.
One application of quantum technologies is enabling unhackable communications. Researchers right now are able to send perfectly secure messages through fibers from one point, or what researchers call a node, to another. And more than that, researchers are able to connect these nodes together into larger networks.
There are now, in the US, quantum networks with several nodes, including one here in the Midwest connecting Argonne National Lab, Fermi Lab, and the University of Chicago. It's networks like these that are bringing us closer to making a quantum internet, or a perfectly secure web of communication.
Joining us today is Nadya Mason, a professor of physics at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, who does research on quantum communication. Professor Mason, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me. Lovely to be here.
We wanted to start off by asking you what you and your group do research on.
Great. So I work on quantum materials. Quantum communication is really the application. There are companies who are using that right now, who are using quantum bits to send information in a way that, in a more secure way than you can send with classical bits, right? That no one can peek in and see what's happening without that state changing. So that's already being used. But at the basis of all these applications is a material. You think of your phones, for example. They do all sorts of processing and things, but at the heart of them is a piece of silicon, right? Which actually has bits on it that does the processing. So quantum communication does the same thing. You have advanced applications, but fundamental to all of these things are materials. In my research, we study the fundamentals of these relevant materials.
Tell us more about how you got into quantum and materials research in the first place.
Yeah, it's funny. I didn't really have a really strong background in physics in high school. I took one elementary physics class, so I think I did classical mechanics. And yeah, for me personally, I didn't really want to be a scientist until I did internships and I did actual research, because classes are fine and some of them were really interesting, but you don't get a sense of what you can do with it and how fun it is to do the practical work. And for me, I really did like thinking my way through problems, thinking about what the underlying science was and how to understand the world in that way, and understand the world in terms of quantum mechanics, which is really a special and unique way to understand it. So that was what, you know, doing that research is what was the most exciting to me and what really inspired me to want to go on in the field.
So I was hoping you could also provide our viewers who are watching a little bit of advice that you would have that either you wish you knew before you got into the quantum research field or things that you think is important for them to know.
The cheat code for having a successful career in quantum, I think, is very similar to the cheat code for having a successful career anywhere, which is curiosity, right? You just have to want to learn about this topic. You have to want to think about the topic. I mean, I think that most of the success that people have in their fields is because they care about learning. They really want to know more. And this is another field that the more you want to know, the more you'll be inspired to know and learn. So I think curiosity and really wanting to learn about the field is just the most important thing.